Hello and welcome to Trey TV. It's always exciting to be here, always exciting to talk about amazing things that are happening here in Houston and throughout the country because we have such great talent, such great artists, and today is no exception. We are joined by Charles Sapp. You might know him as a musician, right? Well, as a writer and talented artist who has created sounds and music and done amazing things in the community for social justice and community well-being. He is here to talk about his latest work, and we are glad to have you with us.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for joining us.
Wow, you know, that's a lot of honors you put on me.
Well, you wear
What's
them
the
well.
saying? I like when you under promise and over deliver or something.
Yes. Well,
Yes.
we're gonna have to keep over delivering because you are keeping the work going, which I think is super exciting. You have such a huge array and a huge amount of talent, which
Thank
I've
you.
always been very impressed with. And you do have some recent works. But before we get into that, you are a writer. If
Yes.
you could explain to our audience how you got into writing, sort of the long way, short way. It's been a very unorthodox. It's not like you started out as a musician or an artist young.
Right.
Explain that journey for us.
My grandfather was a professor at the University of Houston, and he was a writer. And so, me and my siblings, my brother and my sister, we would go over to my grandparents' house, and my grandfather would always be writing. He wrote a book. It was like 30 years in the making. Every time we went over his house, there were just papers all over the place. So I was going to say that there was no one in my family that I knew that was a writer, but my grandfather was a writer. But he never went over, told me about literary techniques or anything like that. Although my grandmother was an English teacher, and so she always corrected me and my siblings as far as our diction. If we went to the store or the mall, I couldn't say me, Jerome, and Aisha went to the mall. I had to say Jerome, Aisha, and I. You
Sure,
know what I
Aisha.
mean?
It came in
So,
handy.
along with English and literary education that she would give us, it was also etiquette as far as keep your elbows off the table kind of stuff. But for me, like writing, I started writing because growing up in a single family home, single parent home, and so many other kids, I felt like I had half of the engagement of having a full family. There was no father figure there. So any questions I had about just growing up as a young boy, or any fears I had or anything of that nature, I think there was a lot of stuff I didn't feel comfortable necessarily talking to my mom about with girls. So I would journal. And I just assumed, like, I assumed that all kids were journaling. I think that's one of the fallacies with our talents is that sometimes things that come the no most natural, you assume that everybody is doing those things, so you take those talents for granted or those gifts for granted, because the desire to engage in those things came naturally for you. So no one made me write. It was just something that I took great joy in. So writing was actually my first love. And it's interesting because at the same time I really enjoyed sports growing up. I was a huge Detroit Lion fan, even though I'm from Houston. I was a Houston Oiler fan,
You have to say
but
that. You need to
I gotta say that. That's right. So my Houston friends don't disown me. Right. But I was a huge Detroit Lion fan because there was Barry Sanders, the running back, and Detroit wasn't very good. I'm sure that Barry Sanders is the reason why so many millions of other people were Detroit Lions fans, not for the sake of Detroit as the team. I don't have anything against the city of Detroit. I love the city of Detroit. I've known some people from there. It seems like a great town. But Barry Sanders was the claim to fame for the Detroit Lions. And in so many ways, I saw myself as an athlete throughout my youth, and I just identified with the athletic side of myself. And then writing was some, so there was writing and sports. mm-hmm. were like my two loves. But writing came first, essentially.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, it's interesting when you describe the two. One is very public. As an athlete, you played in a very public setting. But writing was a very private and a very sort of journaling, I would think, would be a very personal piece.
Yes.
What was it that made you say, this is not just for me, although those are very personal things that you might have been writing about, but I'm willing to sort of put this out there for other people to listen to or to critique or to have an opinion about what you wrote?
Oh, yeah, that's a good point. I think I was pretty shy growing up, and so writing was something that I kept just for myself. I think it was almost like the dying of my second love. I played football here in Houston growing up through high school, and then I moved away, went to college in Colorado, went to Colorado State for a year, and it was a little cold out there.
I can imagine.
It was a little cold out there, and it was a small town. It wasn't, there wasn't a whole lot going on. So I started a journey where I moved to Georgia, and then I moved to New York, lived in Brooklyn. And then I came back to Houston. It's like the hero's journey in Greek mythology, where the hero must leave his or her hometown, battle the Cyclops and return. Yes. But I walked on to U of H football, University of Houston football, at when I was 23 years old. And so I did the college football thing, got a little playing time. But the aspirations of playing in the NFL didn't really pan out. I really didn't have a lot of film because it's just my mind and my desires were all over the place living in Brooklyn. And I was with Next Model Management out there, and I modeled with Sean John and FUBU and Macy's and a couple other clothing lines. So I didn't really spend enough time in the sport. So I had a decent amount of talent, but not a lot of film.
And you were kind of you were living your life at that point, not just focused on football. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So that's the experience I wouldn't trade for anything. Those are like some of the best days, some of the best years of my life, living in Brooklyn and in Queens, and just really discovering who I was as an individual, and being separated from my second love, football and sports. But still working out and things like that. But coming back to Houston, playing at U of H was a great opportunity. But as when that journey came to an end, and I pursued the NFL route, and that didn't really work out. And so I was left with the question of, well, who am I? And like, what is my purpose in the world? That's when Kleenex, where the Kleenex.
Yeah, it's very sobering.
Kleenex.
I'm sure.
Yes. So, but that's when it was kind of light bulb moment for me, when I felt like I was free falling in my life. Is at some point it dawned on me. I realized that before I joined the football team in seventh grade, I was already writing. Well before then, because I just identified with myself as Charles, the athlete, and I think so many other people they identify with just one particular thing, whether it's science or math or athletics. But I realized that writing was actually my first love, so I decided to spend a little bit more time in cultivating myself as a writer, because that's something that even when I was pursuing football and things like that, I was still writing a little bit, but I wasn't creating songs. It was mostly poetry. All of my life has just been it's been poetry, and poetry is beautiful. I say just poetry. Poetry is a fantastic thing, but I started to expand my horizons as far as what I would be writing about content-wise and also what medium of writing I was going to be doing. And that's how I got into songwriting.
Well, you know, you are really modest about it. I happen to have sort of passed you on your journey as you were transitioning into writing and writing into music. So let me not say the writing, but sort of beginning to where you were writing for song. Mm-hmm. And you did a lot of research. Like, what was that like? I think for the viewers who are watching to understand that it wasn't that you understood music necessarily or what people enjoy listening to or how to put your words to song. Mm-hmm. What was that process like when you realized I'm not writing poetry for poetry's sake anymore,
right,
that I'm actually going to be writing as an artist from the music industry?
Yeah. Oh, wow. It was scary. I think you have to get into a level of psychology. Mm. Because after I finished college football and everything, I started as a personal trainer, mm-hmm, in fitness. And so as a personal trainer, you have to study human personality. Mm-hmm. And it's been my experience. I could be completely wrong, but I feel that bravery is not a common human trait. No. Because, you know, generally when people feel some type of pain, then they stop, mm-hmm, and exercise. And generally when people feel some type of discomfort emotionally, then they choose an easier route with less challenges emotionally or physically. Because you asked me what that process was like. Essentially, for most of my life, I was writing poetry for myself. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, to embrace the concept of writing for other people and sharing my work with other people. Mm-hmm. That was like a colossal undertaking, mm-hmm, right there, of fear. Because, mm-hmm, there's judgment.
Yeah.
And so, you know, judgment is a heavy weight.
Yeah.
Because, like, athletically, you know, I could bench press 225 for you 15 times, or I could squat 450 for you.
I can do a little of that.
Yeah.
Not quite.
Well, you're great. I'm sure you could do a lot of that, definitely. So yes.
Plastic.
Right. No, but it's,
physically,
those, so, you know, like, there's physical challenges, but I find that mental challenges are, like, the hardest thing. Mm. Because, like, the first time I did open mic poetry at venue, I had never felt, I've rarely felt that level of fear, mm-hmm, before, mm-hmm, where you sign your name on the list and you hope that there's some kind of glitch, mm-hmm, to where they, like, the list actually becomes erased, so they forget that you actually signed up.
Right.
Because I would have gone home by now, but I already signed up, and so I don't want them to call my name, even though I don't want to go up anymore.
Yeah.
But then you go. But, one of the main factors is a good friend of mine years ago, almost over a decade ago, he told me, he said, Charles, do you know what your problem is? And this is someone that I trust, so I assumed whatever was going to come out of his mouth next, had my best interest at
right,
heart.
Right.
He wasn't just trying to be malevolent or malicious or whatever. But he said, Charles, do you know what your problem is? Is you think your gifts are for you. Hmm. And really that was like a life before, life after, mm-hmm, kind of event right there. And so, yeah, so after that, I spent a lot of time and just studying the art of writing,
yeah,
and sharing, mm-hmm, sharing the art of writing. Mm-hmm. I think the more preparation you have, it builds your confidence,
mm-hmm,
also.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's so many great writers. Like I love the song Hallelujah. Mm.
Yes.
That was, I think, Leonard Cohen wrote that.
Yes.
It's been covered so many times. Sometimes it's hard to know who the original writer was, mm-hmm, but I believe it was Leonard Cohen. And that's just such a brilliant song, and it's amazing. Like I feel almost more competitive as a writer than I was in sports. Mm-hmm. But there's some people I listen to where it just lets me know that there's a whole nother level compared to what I need. I have a lot of work to do. And also, Tennessee Whiskey, Linda Hargrove and Dean Dillon.
Yes.
Where I think a song of that magnitude, it makes sense for there to be multiple writers on there. Because it's hard to imagine if one person could be that genius, even though there are some geniuses out there like that. But Tennessee Whiskey and Hallelujah, and there's a couple other songs. Frank Ocean, his songwriting. Like, when I thought to myself a couple months ago, what are my favorite songs? Mm-hmm. And I don't know if I could, like, name them specifically for you right now, but I think Frank Ocean has three of my favorite songs.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, Bad Religion was a song he wrote. Bad Religion. And Swim Good. Swim Good, Bad Religion, and Wise Man.
Okay.
Yeah, were three brilliant songs by Frank Ocean.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you say that you had to be a student of writing for public experience.
Mm-hmm.
What was that process? And I want to talk about the first songs that you had actually written. The idea of getting those, for those who don't know your journey, of getting that to music, of finding talent, who can express what that was.
Fear.
And even
that's
more
what I'm saying. Each stage, fear.
It's fear. Yes. But even more so, those who wanted to keep you as a trainer, or who only had experienced you as a trainer and an athlete, and them understanding that you had this second talent. Mm-hmm. What was that like when you would say, well, I have this music that I'm trying to do. Could you listen to it? Could you underwrite it? Could you support it? Was that well received, or was that a journey in itself?
I think most people are skeptical of the validity of anything that they hear. There's people that I train, and I've told them that I write music, and they've never heard my music before. And that's fine, because we serve each other a purpose for each other. I'm their trainer, and they're, you know, like a fitness coach and somewhat of a life coach for some people. But like the musical side, they may already have like a playlist that they like that fits their mood. And so some people aren't really thirsty for new music.
So you don't take it personal?
No, I don't take it personal anymore. No, I don't take it personal.
Yeah.
Most people get pretty comfortable and set with their routine, and they go on cruise control. And so, you know, like, I don't want to be desperate for someone to listen to my stories. Mm-hmm. There's plenty of other stories out there. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if you want to listen to a story that I felt that was well curated, that, like, it takes me maybe 2-3 months to write some of these songs. Mm-hmm. Some songs I've worked on, like, there's a song right now I'm working on called Only Beast. It takes place in, like, the Star Wars universe. Yeah. This is a song that's, like, years in the making.
Well, you know, it's interesting to take that song in particular and the notion of the Jedi story and song. Right. What was your inspiration for that, and how does that apply to some of the listeners? How do they relate to the Jedi journey?
Right. Well, it's part of my growth as a writer. So I'm, like, having so much fun with writing at this moment, because I had to start being a little selfish. Because before, my inspiration for writing was to create other people's favorite song. Now my mission is to create my own personal favorite song. Which, you know, to create your personal favorite song is damn near impossible, because there's so much music that you like.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? You're probably, like, the biggest Boy George fan.
There we go.
And Megan Thee Stallion. How can I compete with Megan Thee Stallion and Beyonce in your playlist? Yeah. But for me, myself, it's like, I know my preferences, or I should know my preferences.
Yeah.
And so I've been studying my own personal preferences more. Mm-hmm. Like, what's mainstream artists or independent artists have I had on repeat in my car for, like, the last 2 years? And then I'll study those songs. And what do I like about the lyrics? What do I like about the production? But, like, to your point of the Only Beast song, mm-hmm. Like I strive not to be just a baby, come home, I love you, I miss you, yeah. the end kind of writer.
Yes.
Because there's plenty of those songs yeah. on the radio already. Baby, yeah. I love you, they're wrong about me, come on, I love you, the end. Yeah. And so our principal character in the song doesn't evolve. Like mm-hmm. that person stays the same throughout the story. And you can still create a fantastic song that way. But
you're telling stories.
I want to tell stories. Yeah. Like Tracy Chapman told yeah. stories. Like yeah. Fast Car.
Yeah.
At the beginning of the song, her mother leaves her father. And then at the end of the song, the principal character leaves her husband mm-hmm. and her kids. It's like there's foreshadowing in there. There's like character arcs, mm-hmm. ARC.
You do have.
That's right. No, not a lot of people know about these kinds of things. It's kind of like in The Grinch, where the Grinch wishes Christmas will never come mm-hmm. at the beginning of the story. And at the end of the story, the Grinch saves Christmas. Mm-hmm. It's like a positive character
yeah.
arc.
Yeah.
So as I got more into my studies as a writer, I said, man, I want to tell well-rounded stories, and so Only Beast, the song that I'm going to be, that I wrote, I'm so excited about this song because I created a character that you may not should trust this character.
Mm. Well, you have a line in there that says, mm-hmm. I knew why Jedis go astray.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean for the listener?
Well,
what are your thoughts?
For me, I am a fan of, I am a Star Wars fan. But I'm not, I am a Star Wars fan.
Mm-hmm.
But I like, hopefully this Only Beast song isn't only geared towards Star Wars fans.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's also as a metaphor. A Jedi is a person with immense power. Mm-hmm. I feel like essentially we're all Jedis mm-hmm. in a way. Because we all contain immense powers and gifts.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone's a master of something. Mm. Master liar, manipulator, masters of fashion. And so that's the thing. Everyone's a master of something. Everyone's a Jedi at something.
Mm.
And this story essentially is how a person of immense power loses self-belief mm. or loses hope. And then because life is difficult for all of us. There's like challenges. There's we have certain privileges that other people don't have, but then we have certain hardships that other yeah. people may not have experienced. So everyone has their own journey. And this our principal character that I've written into the story is saying, you know, I see how Jedi lose their way. I see how magnificently beautiful and gifted and talented people lose self-esteem. And then the story goes on to say, in lonely shadows, the dark side's my company. And so it would be nice, like each listener can interpret that any way they choose. But I think that like we all have creature comforts and addictions of some sort. So maybe that's alcohol for some people, or drugs, or bad relationships. Mm-hmm. And so I really enjoyed this song and this story. It's actually a song that I released maybe 4 years ago. It was one of the first songs
mm-hmm.
that I ever released. And in the process of, I have a different singer on the track,
mm-hmm.
and I let some friends listen to it for feedback. Because feedback and criticism is something that I hold most importantly.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I've defriended some people because they said all of my work was great.
And you knew better.
Yeah. Well, you know, everything can't be great.
Mm-hmm.
And how do you feel about this singer? Oh, this singer is awesome. And that singer was awesome too, and everything's great. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I'm not going to be calling you for feedback anymore. So I have some really harsh feedback type of friends,
mm-hmm.
and some would call them a-holes even.
Well, constructive.
Oh,
yeah.
So this is so important. It's good for me to assume people are coming from a good place.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so in the process of like looking for feedback on how the singer was performing the song and the new strings I had added to the song, one of my friends said, you know, there's some parts of the song that I don't feel lyrically fit into this story, like they're part of another story. And so that's my department, the writing aspect, being that I'm not a singer. So I hire the singer to perform the lyrics, and I hire musicians to play the instrumentation. And I curate, of course, I curate the composition and of the music and what instruments to add, and more inflection here is like curating what the singer is doing also. But
so you're open to redoing songs and
Completely. Song is, I don't feel like any song is ever complete. That's why it's amazing to see the work that cover singers do. I think a song can become better over time. So I rewrote maybe 90% of the song.
Oh wow.
Yeah, 15% of me dismissed what that friend said. 85% of me dismissed what that friend said. But 15% of me, it sunk in somewhere. And I was sitting down 2 weeks after that listening session and thinking about edits for the song, and it dawned on me, you know what, that MFO is right.
Right.
Like, I'm not in love with these words anymore myself. Yeah. And so I rewrote the song, make it a little darker and a little more realistic and a little more based on my own life experience. And so that's where the song came from.
So not only do you have to evolve from your writing being your writing to being public writing to figuring out how to make that work with a vocalist and explaining that to the musicians and sort of putting all of these marbles together and somehow creating this piece, you also had to do video production, because nowadays as a musician, it seems that if it has to have a online visual presence to engage. So how did that engage? And then also we'll talk about some of your upcoming transitions in new music, but how was it to incorporate video into the storytelling?
That's tough from a financial aspect.
Right.
So here we go back to fear.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like with working with singers, you have to give them your unpublished music and trust that they're not going to do, like, take your lyrics or your words or share your music. And so there's an element of fear with working with singers. And then, you know, so you get past that. You find a couple singers that you want to work with. Okay, fine. And then now to create like content, then you have to dip into your bank account.
It changes,
I mean, I'm not sponsored by a record label or anything like that. And so that starts to get expensive. And because every project, like the recording process to record a song, to get it ready for to release and to video record a song, everything takes more time, money, and talent than you would have ever wanted to spend. And so that's where we get into, you know, that's harder than lifting weights. Like when you start talking about, you know, you have to have a little bravery. To create art and put it out for people to share. It's amazing to me how many musicians I've met that play three instruments and they have the voice of an angel. And you ask them, where do I find your work? I love what you're doing. Like, you know, it might be someone you see at a coffee shop. Where do I find your work? And it's like, oh, you know, I've been meaning to record myself. And there's so many people that don't record themselves. And if they do, it's just on their phone. Or they have like two videos up on YouTube. And that doesn't make them bad people. There's no judgment in that. It's just, you know, it takes work to record your work and to share your work.
So, Charles, it's always so delightful just learning about your journey and your process. Mm-hmm. But for those who don't understand what that process was like for country music and the three songs that you have recently released, mm-hmm. what was that like for you from a writing point of view mm-hmm. and from switching sort of your demographic?
Oh, yes. Like, we can't go any further in the interview if I don't thank Darian Hernandez. Like, Darian Hernandez is an amazing local musician. He's a multi-instrumentalist. And Darian has helped me through the whole process of being a creator. Like, I wanted to create fun songs. Mm-hmm. I wanted to create fun songs. Songs that you could two-step to, you could groove to, mm-hmm. that also bang. Mm-hmm. Like there's drums in there, guitar, where some of my earlier work was just piano and vocal, because one of my goals is to license music in the future. Some people who have more music experience than me said, well, if you want mainstream artists to take a look at your music, it helps to make it as simple and as stripped down as possible, mm-hmm. with just a vocal and a piano. But now that I'm on a new mission to create my own personal favorite songs, mm-hmm. then, you know, F all of that.
Yeah.
I want some drums, I want the guitar, I want the piano. And so I love these country songs, and I love the storytelling aspect of country. Two out of the three country songs I wrote have a alcohol drinking mm-hmm. message, but like most of my songs, there is a character arc where it's not all about drinking alcohol. The character does end the song with self-belief, mm-hmm. and like in Liquid Diet, our character says, wine and whiskey under bar lights, I'm on a liquid diet tonight, just give me till the sunrise, I'm on a liquid diet tonight. So our protagonist, our main character, is not going to drink their life away because they're sad. They're just realizing, hey, I need for tonight.
So
I'm going to party.
So with Look Both Ways.
And Drink My Sorrows Away.
Just for tonight.
But tomorrow I'm going to pick myself back up and I'm going to believe in myself. I'm going to believe in hope again. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to kick some ass tomorrow.
tonight. I'm drink. So as you talk about Look Both Ways, what really inspired that piece? And what are some of your favorite lyrics and lines out of that?
Oh, yeah. Well, as my studies as a writer, idioms are like a main thing that I've seen in a lot of hooks for popular songs. An idiom, essentially, for those who don't know, is a popular phrase or statement. Mm-hmm. And so Drake is a writer that I like, and like he might say, look alive, mm-hmm. in one of his songs, look alive, look alive. And look alive is a popular idiom. Or you could say walk the walk and talk the talk, or you could say walk it like I tuck it, walk it like I tuck it. It essentially is, you know, it's a popular rap song. So just injecting popular idioms into your music gives your audience some of the familiar with some of the unfamiliar, mm. with your content, and the song might be unfamiliar to them, but the idiom gives them a point of reference, something that a phrase they've grown up with. So Look Both Ways is one of the most popular idioms in any language. Mm. In every language and every culture, you have to have a way of making sure your kids don't get ran over for playing in the front yard, unfortunately, you know? So in English, we say look both ways. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm not sure what the Spanish version.
No pressure. We'll do a multilingual translation.
I'm from Texas. I should know more Spanish. No, but in every culture, every language, look both ways is the most prevalent idiom. So to inject that into this story and to create a character, kind of like my Only Beast song, this is a character that you may not should trust in. Mm. This character isn't all good. Mm-hmm. So to start off the song, your parents may be right about people like me. Yeah. I may never amount to anything. I'm just a kid from a dead-end street. I'd like you to stay, but I think you should leave. Mm. And you should look both ways before you cross this street, essentially. You know, like, you know, your parents, they love you. And if you deal with me, then, you know, things may not end the way that we'd like them to end. Mm-hmm. But also, it's, I think that's like one of the greatest of display of love is this character that I've created is someone that's saying, hey, I like you, but I have problems also.
Being very transparent about that.
Yeah, you need to be careful when you're dealing with me because I have I have personal demons, I have problems.
Yeah.
And then to see how the story ends, like, I think we should look both ways before we cross this street. I'd take you anywhere except for where I'm from. They wouldn't approve of the man I've become, kind of thing.
Wow, very powerful.
So it's good.
I enjoy it. So as we begin to close out and really started to understand
Tennessee whiskey, but we're working on
I'm enjoying it. Well, I think hopefully our viewers will really get a chance to enjoy and be a part of understanding your story and the songs that you have and the meaning and the justification for the why and the how of these characters. Mm-hmm. So as we begin to close out, what is it that's on your next challenge for self?
Okay,
if you know that.
Yes. All right, cool.
Now that jumping in the water.
Now that I've mastered songwriting, easy stuff, this songwriting, music, creating stuff, easy stuff. No, I haven't mastered it. That's a lifelong journey. I'm trying to create better stories.
Yeah.
But I'm working on a photographic project. It's called Homeless, Not Heartless.
Okay.
And so I've been giving makeovers to young homeless adults.
Wow.
And so I photograph, I think, 7 people to date.
Wow.
And so essentially I take before photos and then I help kids get set up with some of the homeless outreach programs in Houston. Mm-hmm. There's Covenant House, which is a great program. Mm-hmm. I volunteered as a flag football coach over there before. And they do a great job in servicing 18 to 21-year-olds. Mm-hmm. And there's a couple other homeless outreach programs. But there's a lot of kids that may have moved to the city, young kids, and they don't know about all of the resources that our great city of Houston has for homeless people of all ages.
Yeah.
But that was something. So after we do that, the homeless outreach program connection and trying to get people housing and education and job, then I do after shots with the person. So I go. I've been going to a resale store, it's just amazing with just a little bit of love and attention how people's self-esteem and self-confidence grows.
Mm-hmm. And what's powerful about what you do is that you actually find individuals. It's not like it's a part of a program. They're not picked because of an application.
Yeah.
You actually, as an individual, go out and and look for individuals who you feel.
Right. Well, like for me growing up, I had a big brother through big brothers, big sisters. Mm-hmm. And so since I didn't have a father influence at home, my mom had the bright idea that it would be cool for me to get some mentorship through big brothers, big sisters. Mm-hmm. So I had a big brother that would pick me up and take me to Rice University to play football in the football stadium. Mm-hmm. Over there, he would pick me up like twice a month. Mm-hmm. And this was a young white kid. Mm-hmm. He was a student at Rice.
Yeah.
And that was major, like for me in middle school, to go to the other side of town to an Ivy League school.
Yeah.
So really, like, mentorship and outreach is something I believe firmly, and that's like changed my perspective and my horizon in life. Right. And so my big brother Paul was and still is a great guy.
That's great.
And my Homeless Not Heartless project is through my nonprofit Fit Beat Kids, FIT BEAT Kids, KIDZ. I have a Facebook link on that. And so I've been doing mentorship for over a decade now. But this project is super fun, working with kind of older kids now, older adults.
That's great. Mm-hmm. So your gifts, they keep giving. You have.
Yeah. that's my whole thing. Like my friend told me is that your gifts are not for you. Mm-hmm. And I would say that for even the people out here is that, you know, do you know what your problem is? Is you think your gifts are for you. Mm-hmm. Your gifts are not for you. They're for us. They're for everybody. So that's the thing is it takes a little bit of courage and bravery and just getting out there and sharing what you have.
That's
sharing
great.
What you have, your own personal perspective.
So for those who want to experience your perspective and buy your music and mm-hmm. sort of see your artwork, where can they find Charles Sapp? Under what name as a writer? And mm-hmm. under what name as a entrepreneur and
the corner store?
Yeah, I
hang out at the corner store, right around the corner. That's where y'all can find me.
Any corner
I'm
USA.
Kenfolk, I got that work in my trunk.
No,
where, my music.
Where can they actually purchase it?
Oh, I'm on Spotify and okay. iTunes and all the digital stores. And Charles Sapp, SAPP, is my last name. And my Homeless Not Heartless project is on display at Art on the Avenue and a couple other art galleries. And on YouTube, I'm on YouTube, Charles Sapp Music, and Instagram at Charles Sapp Music. And
there's more to come.
Facebook, yeah. That's right.
Well, at least you're consistent. It's Charles Sapp.
Charles Sapp.
That's great. Some people have a lot.
There's a lot of other Charles Sapps out there, man.
But none with
Papa
the same
was
talent.
A Rolling Stone.
All juniors, too.
Well, we're so glad to have you with us. So glad for your journey and for pushing through and for sharing your story with Trey and for all of the
Thank
viewers out there.
Thank you for having me. This has good. Been an honor. I appreciate you.
Indeed. We'll have you back again.
Yes.
And for everyone else, enjoy the rest of the day.
Yes. And thank you for the studio here.
Oh,
this is
indeed.
Amazing.
Incredible.
Thank you, Jackpot Studio.
Yes.
World class. World
indeed.
Class. Yes,
indeed.
Yes, yes.
We'll be back again. This is an incredible space, incredible talent.
And Skylar, you're amazing too. Thank you very much.
Indeed.